Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Our first keynote speaker for today is Professor Diana Hess. Professor Hess is the School of Education Dean at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Under her leadership, the school has established new initiatives focused on strengthening and expanding its efforts around teacher education, diversity and inclusion, global engagement, professional learning, and community partnerships. The school has advanced its research mission by investing in new research centers to jumpstart innovative and interdisciplinary research. Professor Hess holds the Karen A. Falk Distinguished Chair of Education, and she was elected to the National Academy of Education in 2019. She will be delivering her keynote entitled Schooling to Build Robust Societies. Professor Hess, please.
Thank you for the lovely introduction. And to my many hosts in Singapore, thank you as well for your warm and generous hospitality. I've been to Singapore before, but even though I've been here less than a week, I have learned so much. I've met with master teachers, curriculum writers, and researchers from the Ministry of Education. I spent one afternoon last week at an extraordinary school. I had the pleasure of attending a multi-day international meeting hosted by NIE and convened by Director Christine Goh. I had the pleasure of having lunch with the permanent minister, Mr. Lai. I visited the National Museum of Singapore to learn from the new exhibition on dislocation, memory, and meaning of the fall of Singapore. I have talked with so many educators in so many roles about the many strengths of education in Singapore and the challenges that you are facing as well. And now I have the distinct honor to address the more than 1,000 educators attending the Redesigning Pedagogy International Conference. To everybody in the auditorium and to all of you online, I want to begin with a hearty good morning. Let me try that one more time. Good morning. As you can see, my talk is titled Schooling to Create Robust Societies. I'm not sure I've ever seen those three words in a title before, and perhaps neither have you. So let me explain what it means. Robust societies are healthy, they are strong, and thriving. They are dynamic, they're not static, and they are not perfect because no societies are. But they are striving and yearning to be better. Robust societies require people to be all in. They cannot be created or nurtured by just a few. And while there is an intrinsic connection between schooling and robust societies, it's important to focus on everybody in our society. Young people, from the wee little ones in early childhood education to older students in technical institutes and universities, are important to the creation of robust societies, as are their elders. But just as their elders were taught and shaped and nurtured by schools, so too must schooling be principally concerned with not what we are, but with what we will become. There are many ways that schooling can help create robust societies. But today, I'm going to argue for a particular approach to schooling that helps young people work on one very important question: how should we live together? I want you to notice that the question is perennial. It's impossible to imagine a time when societies don't have to answer the question, because societies, by definition, are dynamic. I want you to notice that the question is broad and it's overarching. It's a mega question of sorts. It's deliberative, signaled by the word should, and it's not individualistic. Notice the words we and together. But I imagine you are a bit perplexed because as teachers, you know that some questions are simply more discussable than others. And this question, how should we live together, doesn't seem like it would make for a surefire lesson plan. And you're right. It would not because it is too broad. It lacks the precision and focus that would enable students to know what they're actually supposed to be talking about. But consider these questions. From the new Singapore Social Studies curriculum that will be released in August, is harmony achievable? From the remarkable new book on curriculum for justice and harmony by my friends and colleagues, Professors Lee Ching Ho and Keith Barton, how can hunger be prevented and alleviated? From the horrifying massacre of 19 children and teachers in Texas last Friday, should the United States adopt stricter gun control laws? While the topics and types of these questions are quite different from one another, they are all examples of the larger overarching question of how we should live together. Teaching students the knowledge, the skills, and dispositions to engage in thoughtful discussion and deliberation of questions such as these can help ensure that students will be a crucial part of creating the robust societies we should want and need. That's my thesis. Now, you can decide at the end of the talk whether it's persuasive. But let me begin with a brief roadmap of the argument I'm going to make today. First, classroom talk is critical, and in particular, discussion and deliberation. I will explain the difference among different types of talk and what we know about what students learn from them. Second, a focus on important questions and issues about topics that are meaningful and important needs to be the heart of what students talk about. I will explain the difference among events and topics and problems and questions and issues. Then I'll turn to a very challenging decision that teachers have to make, whether to teach a question or an issue as open or as settled. Open means that we assume that there are multiple and competing right answers, and settled means that there is a particular answer that we want students to build and believe. There are many reasons why this is challenging, but perhaps the most important is that issues tip over time, meaning that they change from open to settled and from settled to open, and it's often very hard for schools and for teachers to decide whether to be on the front edge or on the back edge of the tip. During this part of the talk, I will use very concrete examples, mini case studies of a sort, including the incarceration of Japanese Americans during World War II in the United States, the Russian war against Ukraine, and the very problematic linkage between a student's family's wealth and how well they do in school. This is a problem I know in Singapore, the United States, and many other nations as well. Finally, I will explain what literally decades of research have taught us about what teachers do who are good at teaching their students how to participate in high-quality discussions and deliberations. So let me begin by talking about classroom talk. Now, I've never been in a classroom without talk. In some classrooms, the teachers do most of the talking, but in most classrooms, students talk too. And in classrooms where students are learning a lot, there are many different types of talk. Students may be listening to a clear, engaging, accurate, and evocative explanation by a teacher of a very challenging idea. In other words, a great lecture. Students may be engaged in what researchers call IRE. The teacher initiates the talk with a question. Say, for example, why did the Japanese invade Singapore? Then students respond, and the teacher signals through some kind of evaluative response something about the quality of the student's answer. In many classrooms, there's a lot of talk in pairs and in small groups for good reason, because many voices mean more brains are working on a problem. And pairs and small groups will demand participation of both talking and listening. Now, as we learned from the cooperative learning movement of the 1980s, paired discussion works well because, quite frankly, it's hard to escape from a pair. Imagine this. After examining data on the relationship between the use of fossil fuels and global warming, a teacher asked students to think individually about how they would best characterize the relationship. Then students are put in pairs, and they talk about what they thought about with a partner, and perhaps also identify the similarities and differences in their characterizations. That's think, pair, share, a great classroom talk strategy because it requires students to think, which is always a good thing, and to explain their thinking, which is another good thing, and to learn about someone else's thinking, which, quite frankly, is a fabulous thing. Now, it's relatively easy to define lecture, IRE, and think, pair, share, but defining discussion and deliberation is more challenging, in part because there are very many definitions of those words. We call them essentially contested concepts. In my own research, I have found time and time again that it is hard for teachers not to conflate classroom talk per se with discussions, which is why in professional learning courses on classroom discussion, I work hard to define what it is. Here's an example. In 2016, in response to racist incidents on the campus where I work, campus leaders asked for ideas about educational interventions that could be created that would enhance diversity, equity, and inclusion goals. With my colleagues, we created a program for instructors on our campus, for faculty, for staff instructors, and for advanced graduate students called simply and aptly the Discussion Project. We argued that discussions that focused on both high-quality talk and broadly inclusive talk had the potential to not only teach students things that only discussion can teach, but to also advance diversity of thought and participation, equity and inclusion. Now, early on, we realized that the university instructors thought classroom talk of any sort was the same as discussion. So we got very clear about how we defined discussion. Our definition in the Discussion Project is that discussion is focused inquiry through speaking and listening that is purposeful, broadly collaborative, and that leads to understanding through analysis of different perspectives. Now, the Discussion Project is for instructors of every subject, from Arabic to zoology, we like to say. And due to that, we needed a definition that wasn't content specific. There are lots of definitions of discussion, and I don't want to suggest that ours is the be-all and end-all. But it is working for us because we can teach people what it means, and more importantly, teach them what they need to do to create discussion of this sort in their classes. As an aside, even though our current focus in the Discussion Project is on university instructors, we are developing a secondary version of the project that will be field tested in the United States and Canada in the next several months. Now let's turn to what deliberation means. Again, like discussion, it is contested, but Latin can help us here. The noun deliberation comes from a Latin word meaning to weigh, or more broadly, to weigh and examine. My great teacher and friend, Walter Parker, framed deliberation as discussion with an eye toward decision making. We must make a decision about what should be done. Here's an example that can help make a distinction between discussion and deliberation. Since my arrival in Singapore last Tuesday, I have asked lots of teachers about how the Russian war against Ukraine is being talked about in Singapore schools. Yesterday, Elaine Lim from the ministry sent me a document entitled The Cost of Conflict, developed by CCE staff and shared, I understand, with all educators in Singapore. I must say that it is impressive and comprehensive. It is infused with questions throughout, many that seem ripe for discussion. For example, what is the impact of the conflict on Ukrainian civilians? And what is the potential impact of the conflict on Singapore? They are good questions that are ripe for discussion, but as the war continues, I imagine that many nations will have to have deliberations about whether their responses should change, whether they should be more or perhaps less. And those questions will require deliberation because a decision is necessary. As a general rule of thumb, if the word should is in a question, it most likely calls for deliberation and not discussion. So what do we know about what students learn from discussion and deliberation? I like to characterize the distinction between teaching with discussion and deliberation and teaching for discussion and deliberation. Teaching with quite simply means that you're using discussion and deliberation as a vehicle, as a pedagogical tool in order to teach students important content information, in order to help them consider multiple perspectives, in order for them to build the skill and the disposition of intellectual charity, in order to help them build empathy, in order to help them think and to weigh and to balance. Teaching for discussion, on the other hand, is designed to help young people improve their ability to participate effectively in discussions and deliberations. So in teaching for, we want students to learn how to talk with clarity and with succinctness. We want them to learn what good examples are. We want them to learn how to ask questions, and most significantly, we want them to learn how to listen. Now, I'm often asked how we should make a determination about what students should talk about. And I want to give you a very brief overview of the differences between several things that students are often asked to talk about. They're often asked to talk about events, about topics, about problems, about questions, and about issues. Let me give you an example of the difference among these. An event could be the invasion by Russia of Ukraine. A topic could be war. A problem could be the displacement of literally more than a million people in Ukraine. A question could be, how can we best meet the needs of those people who have been displaced? And an issue could be, should our nation be open to refugees from the war? Now, I mentioned before that when teachers are focused on teaching with discussion and deliberation, they encounter a number of challenges. But one that I think is particularly difficult is how to determine whether a topic, a question, or an issue is open or closed. So let me define what I mean by this. An open issue is one for which there's no right answer. We would expect disagreement, and teachers would aim for multiple and competing views. I'm often asked, how do you know if a discussion of an open issue is a high-quality discussion? And I have one standard that I've borrowed from my colleague Tom Kelly. The standard is this: if a person were listening to the discussion, would they hear a best case fair hearing of competing points of view? And if they would, most likely the discussion is at least on the path to being high quality. A settled issue, on the other hand, is a question for which there's a right answer that teachers want students to build and believe. And I need to tell you that this conception of anything being settled in education is sometimes profoundly disturbing to educators. And I don't think it needs to be, because I think if we're honest about what we teach, there are many things that we teach as settled issues. For example, I was a high school history teacher for many years, and I taught a unit on how women in the United States gained the right to vote. At the end of that unit, I wanted students in the United States to believe that it was a good thing that women gained the right to vote. In other words, I was teaching that as a settled issue. Here's another example, however, of something being taught as a settled issue. As you can tell from the many examples I've already given you, I'm quite interested in what's happening in Ukraine. And I'm quite interested in how teachers around the world are teaching about what's happening in Ukraine. I've done a lot of reading about what's happening in Russia. And in particular, in Russia, teachers are being told that the word invasion or war cannot be used when teaching about Ukraine. And in fact, the reasons why Russia was justified in invading Ukraine have got to be at the heart of the lesson plan. And if they are not, teachers are literally being imprisoned. That is an example of a quintessential closed approach to teaching about an issue. There are empirical issues and there are policy issues. And both of those can be taught as either open or closed. So here's an example of an empirical issue. Is there a relationship between human behavior and climate change? For many decades, there was a lot of debate about what the answer was to that question. It was taught as an open issue. Now, I think in most schools, that is taught as a closed issue, meaning that contemporary science has taught us that there is a relationship between climate change and the behavior of humans. So that's an example of a closed empirical issue. Now, what we know about science and social science is things change over time. So just because something is settled doesn't mean it will be settled forever. And there are also empirical issues that can and should be taught as open. Think about all the issues having to do with COVID-19. There are some issues for which we think we have pretty good answers, but there are many issues for which scientists are still deliberating. Those are examples of open issues that are empirical. In a similar vein, policy issues can be taught as either open or closed. And to illustrate this, I want to tell you about my own teaching from, unfortunately, many decades ago. So I was teaching, as I mentioned, U.S. history in a very large high school, over 5,000 students. And we used a textbook called The American Dream by a man named Lou Smith. At the time, it was considered one of the most progressive textbooks in the United States. And one reason for that was every chapter ended with a controversial issue that students were being asked to deliberate. Most of those controversial issues were based in history. And for years, when we got to the unit on World War II, students learned about the incarceration of Japanese Americans in the United States during World War II. Some of you have never heard of this. Beginning in 1942, over 100,000 Japanese citizens and Japanese American residents were incarcerated for the length of the war. That was known back in the day as the internment of Japanese Americans. It's now being called the incarceration of Japanese Americans. And in the book, The American Dream, it was presented as an open issue. Here was the question. Was the internment of Japanese Americans justified? And I remember teaching literally hundreds of students how to deliberate that question. They examined reasons and evidence to support the fact that it was justified, and they examined reasons and evidence to support the fact that it wasn't justified. And I did this for a number of years, and then I started getting, quite frankly, queasy about it. As I was learning more about the true history of the incarceration of Japanese Americans, it became clear to me that most likely it was going to be extremely difficult to come up with well-warranted arguments to support the view that the internment of Japanese Americans was justified. So I turned to one of my senior colleagues, Dave Harvey, and I said to Dave Harvey, "Dave Harvey, I don't think we should be teaching about the incarceration of Japanese Americans this way anymore. We should not be teaching it as an open issue. We should be teaching it as a settled issue." And the reason for that is that there's much more evidence about why Japanese Americans were actually interned. The society was changing its views on whether or not the internment of Japanese Americans was warranted. The United States government issued a formal apology, and Congress passed a bill that was signed that provided reparations for people and their descendants who had been interned. Now, Dave Harvey said an interesting thing to me. He said, "Diana, when I started teaching U.S. history, we did teach the incarceration of Japanese Americans as a closed issue, but the answer was that it was justified." So what had happened with this issue? When he started teaching, it was taught as a closed question, that the United States was justified in interning Japanese Americans. When I started teaching, and for years, we taught it as an open issue. Students deliberated, was this justified? And now I was saying to Dave Harvey that I thought the issue needed to be closed again. It needed to be closed and taught as a massive violation of the human rights of Japanese Americans. It needed to be taught in this way. When asked the question, was the United States justified? The answer is no. That is an example of a phenomenon that I call tipping. The reality that issues can go from open to settled, they can go from settled to open to settled again. And as I mentioned at the beginning, this can be very challenging for teachers, because teachers have to decide, like I did, do you want to be on the front end of the change, or do you want to be on the back end of the change? And what I've noticed helping teachers think about this, including here in Singapore in the year 2010, is that teachers disagree intensely about whether an issue should be taught as open or closed, and they disagree about what criteria should be used to make a decision. Let me give you an example. Before I came to Singapore in 2010, I had read about this thing called outside the boundary markers. I had never heard of outside the boundary markers, and I was really intrigued with it. What's outside the boundary of what should be taught, and who gets to decide? And are people in agreement about that? So with a number of educators here in Singapore, I created an activity for teachers to look at a whole list of questions, of issues, including issues like this. Should women participate in required national service? Should we get rid of streaming in schools? And so on and so forth. These were all issues. And I asked the teachers to make a decision about a couple things. First, is this an issue that should be taught in schools in Singapore? And second, if it is taught, should it be taught as open or closed? And then I watched as the teachers worked in small groups, intensely disagreeing, even teachers who were literally teaching in the same school right next to one another. A number of teachers said to me, "I think this should be taught, but I know it is an outside the boundary marker." And at that point, some staff people from the Ministry of Education stood up and said, "We don't think it is. We, in fact, think it is something that should be taught." So what did I learn from that? Well, what I learned is that it is extremely important for teachers not to make a decision in the moment about whether they should teach something as open or settled. That, in fact, it's really important to deliberate about what kinds of things we want to open up for students to deliberate and what kinds of things we don't want to open up. Let me turn for a moment to what we know students learn from discussion. And I want to go back to the concept of teaching with and teaching for. When students participate in discussion, we know that if the discussion is high quality, that students build important content knowledge that they most likely would not build on their own. Brain research teaches us why. That multiple perspectives, different views on issues, different questions, different kinds of evidence build important content knowledge. And teachers will often say to me, when do we know that students are ready to discuss? Because I don't want students discussing without any background, because we would call that not discussion, but quite frankly, blather. And we don't want blather in the classroom. Many teachers think that if students learn a mass of content, that they will be able to discuss effectively. And I think, in fact, that that is true. But more often the case is that students are learning so much content that when time comes to discuss, the school year is over. So what we need to do is make a decision about how much is enough. Students need to know something before they discuss. Otherwise, they won't be able to participate effectively in discussion. And this is why the central feature of all good discussions that I've ever seen in classrooms is that they are not spontaneous. Now, I don't know about movies in Singapore, but movies about teaching in the United States often go like this. There is a typically very young teacher dressed in very hip clothing, and she asks a question, often a provocative question. And all of the students in the class appear to be highly engaged, highly motivated, and they raise their hands, they want to participate in the discussion. And I want to suggest to you that that does not happen in real classrooms. That happens in Hollywood. What we know about high quality discussion is that preparation really matters. And if students prepare to discuss, they're much more likely to learn more content. The other thing we know about high quality discussion is that it's extremely important for teachers to help students develop norms of what constitutes civil discussion compared to what constitutes discussion that is less civil. I don't want to suggest to you that discussions in classrooms should be devoid of emotion. In fact, the most recent research that's been done of controversial issue discussions here in Singapore shows that the role of emotion is extremely important in high quality discussions. But I do want to suggest to you that if students learn norms of what constitutes a high quality discussion, they're much more likely to, one, feel like they want to participate, and two, participate in a way that is productive. In my own research, I've learned that students often fail to participate in discussion, not because they don't know what they want to say, not because they fear their teacher, but because they're afraid of what their peers will think and what their peers will say. And the only thing that I know to counter that is to develop strong norms of discussion and ways in which all students can be encouraged to participate. The other thing that we see in high quality discussion is that there are different kinds of discussion that produce different kinds of outcomes. Some kinds of discussion are large group discussions that are focused very principally on a text, and students are trying to understand the issues, ideas, and values in a text. That would be called the Socratic Seminar, and I know it's used in lots of classes in Singapore. Another kind of discussion, structured academic controversy, is designed to help students talk about open issues in a way where they have to thoughtfully consider multiple perspectives, because they prepare for and advocate one position, and then they have to switch sides and prepare for and advocate another position. But the real meat, the real gold of structured academic controversy happens after that, when students have what we call an open discussion, where they're talking about their own views on the issue after thoughtfully considering the multiple perspectives. So I want to talk just briefly about a study I did that resulted in a book called The Political Classroom. In this study with a colleague, Paula McAvoy, I went into lots of different kinds of classrooms. They were small schools, large schools, schools in cities, schools in farming communities, religious schools, and schools that were not religious. And in these classrooms, we were looking for high-quality discussion, and we were trying to figure out not only what do teachers do, but what do students learn? And then we did something that, at least in the United States, in my field, is very unusual. We followed students 2 and 4 years out after they graduated from high school to find out whether what they had learned in those classrooms stuck. And if it stuck, in what ways? So in a nutshell, here's what we learned. In high-quality classrooms with discussions of open controversial issues that happened quite frequently, students learned how to value multiple perspectives in a way they reported not learning in other classes. They learned how to ask questions of their peers and how to listen thoughtfully to their peers' answers. They learned important content. And most importantly, they learned that there was a we to decision making. One student that we interviewed 4 years after he graduated from high school talked about the fact that his teacher had taught him how important it was to ensure that when decisions are being made, especially critical decisions, that we thoughtfully take into account the perspectives of many different people. And he talked about how that affected him at the university, and he talked about how that affected him as a citizen, that he was more likely to pay attention to the news, that he was more likely to vote. And we found those effects across literally hundreds of students. So what did that teach me? It taught me that in classrooms with high quality discussion and deliberation, we are actually teaching students to build a more robust society. Because what those students explained to us characterized, by definition, a society in which problems are going to be handled forthrightly, in which decisions are going to be considered thoughtfully, and in which there is a we, not just an I. Let me end, before I take questions, with just one thought. As I mentioned to you at the beginning, I've talked to a lot of teachers and a lot of educational leaders in Singapore over the last week, and I came to Singapore already knowing quite a bit about your system. And I am impressed. And here's what I'm impressed by. In Singapore, there actually is a system. There's a system that connects research to teaching. There's a system that connects research to professional learning. There's a system that connects teachers to professional learning. And there is a system for creating high-quality curriculum. Now, I bet to most of you in Singapore, that just seems, well, natural. Like, that's the way it is. And in fact, I want to say to you that that's highly unusual. In many nations around the world, there aren't systems that are as tightly coupled as yours. That instead, in many places around the world, there's a huge focus put on teachers, as there should be. But there's not as much focus put on how we can support teachers through a strong system so teachers can do their very best. So I come away from my week in Singapore impressed by what you've already accomplished. And I come away impressed by the fact that I know if I come here 10 years from now, you will have moved beyond what you're doing now, because in fact, you are using schooling to create a more robust society. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Hess. Now, there's some questions we've received via the Slido link, and we will highlight one question for Professor Hess to take. The question reads, settled issues sounds like it is resolved by the perspective of the teacher involved. What if the perspective is different from social norms? Would it do more harm?
I want to make sure I understand the question. I hear the question to be asking this. Who decides whether an issue is open or settled? And what's the distinction between what's happening with respect to social norms about that issue and what's decided about how to present it in the classroom? In fact, I think that teachers often do make that decision. I think they're less likely to make that decision in a society like Singapore, where there's a very highly defined curriculum. In many other nations, the curriculum is much more homegrown, and teachers are much more likely to be making that decision on their own. Although, as I said, it's extremely important for them to be making it without doing it in the moment. What's the relationship between social norms and whether an issue is taught as closed versus settled? Let me give you an example. In the United States, and I know in Singapore, there's a lot of concern about growing inequality, economic inequality. And there's a lot of concern about evidence that suggests that if a student's parents are wealthy, that student is going to do better in school than if a student's parents are not wealthy. This is not unique to Singapore. In fact, I have never been in a society where this does not occur. But what I understand is that this is an issue now that is being talked about more robustly than it would have been 10 years ago. That 10 years ago, this problem most likely existed, but it probably wasn't being talked about in schools. And now, because the social norms around the acceptance of the fact that A, that's a problem, and B, we need to deal with it, is most likely going to cause it to come into the curriculum. So I do think there's a relationship between what happens outside of school and what happens inside of school. One example from the United States, in the 1960s, the Supreme Court issued an opinion saying that interracial marriage was legal. Before then, there were a number of states in the United States that literally made it against the law for people from different races to marry. After that Supreme Court decision was decided, public opinion on that issue shifted very quickly. That doesn't always happen as a consequence of court decisions, but it did in this one. And now we know, when we look at opinion polls, that virtually all people in the United States think that racial intermarriage should be legal. So that's an example of tipping, and that's also an example of how social norms have affected what is taught in the curriculum.
Thank you, Prof. Hess. We have some time, so we'll take a second question. The key seems to be for teachers to be open about the issues. How can we encourage teachers who may be more inclined towards didactic teaching to consider their positions on different issues and how they engage students on these issues to deliberate?
So in a nutshell, I think the question is asking this. Let's imagine you have a teacher who's very focused on delivering content knowledge to students. That's what's meant by didactic teaching. And the question is, how can that teacher change from only focusing on didactic teaching to focusing on other kinds of teaching as well, including the discussion and deliberation of issues? Well, in my experience, and I've been doing this for literally decades, it requires a lot of professional learning. I want to go back to just a moment to the discussion project, where at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, we're trying to teach faculty how to teach with discussion. And many faculty, unlike teachers, haven't had any teacher education, none whatsoever. And so when they come into the discussion project, they are starting from a place that's very different from what a teacher who's had teacher education is starting from. Let me give you an example. Earlier I talked about this very easy discussion model called Think, Pair, Share. Well, when we first started the discussion project, we used Think, Pair, Share with the faculty who are participating in the project. I didn't think anything of it. Think, Pair, Share is used all the time. It's no big deal. It's not very hard to do. It is a good form of helping students learn things. The faculty taking this course were amazed. They said things to me like this: who came up with Think, Pair, Share? As if it was some kind of miracle. And what that taught me was that these faculty needed a lot of professional learning in order to shift from being didactic to being much more interactive. And we're studying this. We're trying to figure out what it takes to learn how to have high-quality discussion. And one thing it takes is participating in high-quality discussions yourself. If you've never participated in a good discussion, it's hard to have a vision for what that looks like. Another thing it takes is high-quality curriculum. And for that reason, I'm really intrigued by the curriculum in Singapore across many subject areas that provides explicit opportunities for discussion. Because if the curriculum honors discussion, it's much more likely that teachers will take up discussion. And quite frankly, to become a more discussion-focused teacher, you need to have a lot of practice. In my study, the political classroom, when I looked at the very best teachers, the teachers who quite frankly were just rocking it, it was fabulous to be in their classrooms. It was really fun. And I asked them, how did you get this way? Because clearly you're not born that way. Being a good teacher is something we develop. It's not innate. And they said three things. One, they had very high quality teacher education in which they learned about discussion. Two, they had lots of professional learning. These were not teachers who went through teacher education and never came back for more learning. I know here in Singapore that ongoing professional learning is the norm, but that's not the case everywhere. And these teachers were teachers who were getting lots of professional learning. And the third thing is that they invited people into their classroom to give them feedback. You know, teaching often can feel very lonely. We're in our classrooms not all by ourselves. We have a whole classroom of students, but we don't encounter adults often in our classrooms. And what we know about good teaching is that it's incredibly important to get high quality feedback, not just from students, but from other teachers. So these teachers in the political classroom study who were really good had good teacher education, good professional learning, and they very frequently opened their classroom door to other adults, including parents, in order to get feedback on their teaching.
Thank you, Professor Hess. All right, I would now like to invite Professor Tan Un Sing, convener for RPIC 2022, Center for Research in Child Development, NIE, on stage to deliver a token of appreciation to Professor Hess, please. Professor Hess and Professor Tan.